subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
Afghanistan is on top of our minds, and you are getting live reporting from Naina Basu, my colleague who's there in Kabul. In fact, she's there in Kabul right now as I record this episode of Cut the Clutter. So I will leave that to her. You hear the story from her, you read from her. I will, on the other hand, try to get behind the story. And behind the story in terms of explaining to you who the Taliban are and who the Taliban leaders are. Because you know what? Whether you like the Taliban or not doesn't matter. You still need to know about them. If you like them, in a large country, there can be a few who might or who might now think they'll now become normal, reformed people. I have my very grave doubts. In fact, I have no doubts. I don't think any such thing is going to happen. But if you like them, you want to know about them. If you don't like them, which is a vast majority of people in India and across the world, then you might as well know better about them. Who are the Taliban? Where did they come? Plenty has been spoken or written about that. But who are the leaders today? Who are the faces you will see in days to come? And who are the names you will hear from days to come? So, first of all, Mullah Baradar. Mullah Abdul Ghani Baradar just took over as the president. Took over means he wasn't elected, he was appointed president. So you might think he is the most important person, and we will talk about him. He is a colorful character, and I will tell you more about him. And these are all very young people. The key thing about Taliban leaders is that they don't look young because of the way they are turned out and their long beards and their unkempt style, but they are mostly young by any political standards. Most of them are born after 1960. In fact, the oldest ones generally are 60, 61, 62, one in 68. Why? Because they are the Taliban. So where did they arise from? They arose from the madrasas, the Deobandi Haqqaniya madrasas. That's how the Haqqani group also came in. Deobandiya Haqqani madrasas inside Pakistan. So they were religious students or scholars in their 20s and 30s or even younger. That's the reason now, even 20 years after the war on terror began or Operation Enduring Freedom began, or 25 years after they took over power in Kabul in 1996, they are still people in their late 50s and 60s. And when I give you the list, you will also see many of them have been killed. They've died violent deaths in their 50s and early 60s. So even Mullah Omar, who was the founder of the Taliban in 94-95, even he died just around 60. He was a very young man by any standards, but he had seen and done a lot. How he died in 2013, we don't know, but we do know that the world wasn't sure until 2015 that he had died, because between the Pakistanis and between the Taliban, they had been able to keep it such a secret that even the Americans, the CIA, with all their snooping devices, Afghan intelligence were not able to find out. In fact, it's Afghan intelligence, NDS, which said in 2015 that he had died. Now, probably he died of sickness, as it was said, but there are rumors about what might have killed him, because all of them have faced multiple assassination attempts, not just by the Americans and CIA drones, but also by some of their own and other covert operatives. So Mullah Omar was the founder. With Mullah Omar, Mullah Baradar was a co-founder. But Mullah Omar was the leading light of the Taliban. As he got more busy doing other stuff, and Taliban also came more under attack from the Americans after 2001, after 9/11, he handed over a lot of his military operations to a man called Mullah Ubaidullah. And you will see many of these pictures on the screen as I talk. Mullah Ubaidullah led military operations for the Taliban, and they have a structure like corps commander, area commander, sector commander, etc., etc. Full tamjham is there. So Mullah Ubaidullah was captured by the Pakistanis in 2007, obviously with American help. He was kept in a Pakistani prison. And 2010, again at a very young age, he died of heart disease. So this is a story of द लाइन दैट आई यूज ऑफन, बैठे बैठे महफिल में होता है कोई कैसे गुम, राइट? अब वो ऐसे ही गुम हो गया इन द पाकिस्तानी प्रिजन. सो मुल्ला उबैदुल्ला डाइड एंड मुल्ला उमर देन कंटिन्यूड. बट मुल्ला उमर डाइड आफ्टर हिम हिज सक्सेसर वॉज मुल्ला मंसूर अख्तर. नाउ मुल्ला मंसूर अख्तर टुक ओवर बट द अमेरिकन्स नाउ वर एबल टू ट्रैक हिम. 2016 he was killed in a drone strike. How do I introduce him to Indian audiences? Maybe the best way or maybe the worst way to introduce him as somebody who was supposedly the civil aviation minister. What was civil about the Taliban government, I don't know, but he was supposedly the civil aviation minister of the earlier Taliban government. Also, when IC-814 was hijacked to Kandahar and India suffered the humiliation of our Foreign Minister Jaswant Singh thanking him by addressing him as the Honorable Civil Aviation Minister of Afghanistan. This at a time when India did not recognize the Taliban government. Also, when India took terrorists in exchange for the hostages in the plane and those terrorists came out of the plane, He is the worthy who walked up and happily hugged and embraced. He's the worthy who walked up and embraced with great deal of affection Maulana Masood Azhar. So you know where Taliban are coming from. So he was killed in 2016. He was about 59-60 years old only. So once again, 21 May 2016, he was killed, just 59-60. So I'm repeating the point that these were students, quote-unquote, religious students from madrasas in Pakistan who became fighters, militants, terrorists, leaders, whatever you call them. Jo aapki shraddha hai, aap unko wohi boliye. After that, the commander or the chief or the amir of the Taliban was Haibatullah Akhundzada. And it continues to be so. Haibatullah Akhundzada, again in the same kind of vintage, not an old man. Haibatullah Akhundzada is a very quiet man. He rarely talks. He issues these fatwas and religious orders and injunctions. He's been the head of the Islamic Sharia court for the Taliban. He's more of a religious, conservative religious scholar. Now, one way of knowing a little bit more about the chief Amir now, Haibatullah Akhundzada, is also to see what he was doing. While many of the others were military commanders, while working with the Taliban earlier on in life, he wasn't exactly that. He was always a kind of spiritual theoretician and also a kind of theological teacher. So even when the Taliban were in power, he was a minister. What was he minister of? He was heading the Department of Promotion of Virtue and Prevention of Wise. So once again, if he's now the head Amir or the chief Amir of the Taliban, you can get a sense of what the Taliban government social policies are going to be. Now, some people might say he's just a figurehead, but the fact is he is the Amir. So will this now become an Iran kind of system where you have one president in Iran? It's elected. Unlikely it'll happen in Afghanistan. I'm not saying impossible. I'm saying unlikely. But will it be an Iran kind of system where the Amir, which is Akhundzada, continues to be the supreme chief and the president works under him? Or the president, having been a co-founder and having been a more active person and having more of a star quality to him, will overshadow him and the Amir will become a figurehead? But right now, he is the supreme leader. Now, supreme leader, spiritual leader, there are some things about him that we must remember. When he took over as the supreme leader of the Taliban, one of the first things he did was to swear his loyalty to Ayman al-Zawahiri. Who's Ayman al-Zawahiri? He is the head of Al-Qaeda. He succeeded Osama bin Laden. He's still not been found. In fact, rumors are that he's still been living in Afghanistan. And if at all now, Afghanistan will be the safest place for him, because now Taliban will look after him. So look at the Americans with all their resources and everything at their command. Pegasus raised to the power, God knows how much. They were not able to find Ayman al-Zawahiri. So Haibatullah Akhundzada supreme leader of the Taliban, swore his allegiance to Ayman al-Zawahiri, who immediately proclaimed him Amir of the Faithful. So now Mullah Abdul Ghani Baradar, whose pictures you saw speaking to the media and releasing statements from the Afghan presidential palace surrounded by rifles and other stuff, he has been a fighter on the ground. He's commanded Taliban armed forces, a kind of a commander-in-chief. He, like all the others among the Taliban, all of them cut their teeth fighting alongside the Mujahideen against the Soviets. So they were good young guys then, who were also patronized by the Americans. That's why the lecture that Hillary Clinton gave to Pakistan also applies to America. I mean, if Americans have a mirror, they should also read that lecture to themselves. She said that you cannot raise snakes in your backyard and front yard hoping that snakes in your backyard will not bite you, but front yard might bite you so you can deal with them. It doesn't work like that. Snakes are snakes. Now, the Americans were the ones who patronized the Mujahideen, and I will tell you closer connections there as we go ahead. And Mullah Baradar used to fight then as a young man like all the others, like Mullah Omar. In fact, Mullah Baradar was in Mullah Omar's little unit in Kandahar, and they fought together. And that's how in 94-95, when they thought that the Mujahideen had too much internal fighting and too much factional fighting, they set up the Taliban. Taliban means literally the students. It's a plural for students. So, Mullah Baradar, he co-founded the Taliban with Mullah Omar. In 2001, he famously or infamously offered Hamid Karzai a deal, because as the Americans came in, Hamid Karzai was to rise as the leader of Afghanistan under American tutelage, and Mullah Baradar offered him a deal saying, we'll recognize you, etc., etc., safe conduct. Americans were not very trusting of that. So that did not quite happen. In 2010, for a long time, he was among the most wanted men for the Americans. In 2010, he was caught in a joint US-Pakistani raid. Where else but the favorite hideout in the city of Karachi. So he was caught in the city of Karachi, and then he had been under Pakistani detention all this while. But in one of those mysteries about the smoke and mirror wars, which nobody can resolve, somehow the Americans never pressed too hard to do something about him or maybe take him to Guantanamo Bay. That didn't happen. And 2018, somehow dramatically, the Americans leaned on the Pakistanis to release him. Why? Because they had decided by then that they wanted out of Afghanistan. And if you want out of Afghanistan, you need to have people to negotiate with on the side of the Taliban. So maybe that's why he was kept alive all these years and in Pakistani custody. And then he was released and was allowed to go back to Qatar and base himself there. And that's why all these so-called peace talks have been, or withdrawal talks, basically American surrender talks, have been going on in Doha, in Qatar. Qatar has been the facilitator. So Mullah Baradar then shifted to Qatar. And lo and behold, he is now the president of Afghanistan. Then there's a colorful character called Sirajuddin Haqqani. He featured on all our minds, in all our mind space, when he wrote that famous, or again infamous, I might add that to everything I say about the Taliban, that famous or infamous op-ed article in the venerable, holy, the New York Times. Basically saying the Taliban are not as bad as you might have imagined we were. As you can see it, that was part of a normalization of the Taliban in the American public opinion, because the US knew that they were going to pull out of Afghanistan, leaving Afghans to their own devices. Certainly, they had not imagined that this would look as shambolic as it does right now, causing permanent damage to America's image as a big power and really causing a great deal of anxiety to their allies. But the fact is that he wrote that article. He has been running something called the Haqqani Network. Now, Haqqani Network has a special history of its own, because he's not somebody who came with the founder's circle or the founder's group of the Taliban. He's somebody who came from the founder's group of the Mujahideen. Because his late father, Jalaluddin Haqqani, born in Paktia in Afghanistan, in eastern Afghanistan, on the border with Pakistan, He was one of the foremost commanders of the Mujahideen against the Soviets. And he founded his own group called the Haqqani Network, which in the course of time became a part of Maulvi Yunus Khalis's group, Maulvi Yunus Khalis's Hizb-e-Islami group. You will see Maulvi Yunus Khalis's picture also. And they got a very large number of American Stinger missiles because they were seen to be very successful and very good and very effective at delivering success and bringing down a lot of helicopters. So at that point of time, Charlie Wilson, who was a 12-term Democratic congressman from one of the Texas districts and one of the main sponsors of the Mujahideen, he was really desperate. He had pictures of himself taken holding a Stinger missile launcher, etc., etc. But he was desperate, a former Navy officer in the US, a lieutenant or a lieutenant, as the Americans would say. He was, after he got his pictures with the Stinger launchers, that's when Americans had given Stingers to the Mujahideen, and that had turned the balance of the battle. He really fancied his chances. He really fancied some pictures or real life experience of firing a Stinger and bringing down a Soviet combat helicopter. So much so that he wanted to stage it. So when he wanted to stage it, who did he go to? He went to Mullah Jalaluddin Haqqani, Sirajuddin Haqqani's father, who said, "Okay, boss, I'll organize it for you. Russian helicopters, what's the problem?" So how do you get a Russian helicopter to come and appear in front of your eyes so our honorable congressman can shoot it with a Stinger missile? So story goes that Jalaluddin Haqqani one day kicked up a lot of dust using trucks and whatever in some place to give the Russians an impression that a large unit of something was moving. And he thought that cloud of dust will attract Russian helicopters. So while they waited and Representative Charlie Wilson was lying in ambush with the Stinger launchers, for some reason, Soviets did not take the bait because, you know, whatever you might say, maybe the Soviets are not that stupid. So Charlie Wilson was then denied his wish. That didn't quite happen. But the fact is, it is his son, one of his two surviving sons. He probably had seven sons, and I'll give you a listing. Sirajuddin Haqqani is one of his two surviving sons. And I will give you a listing of what happened to his sons. So let me list his sons sort of backwards. So there was Anas Haqqani, senior member of his group, Haqqani group, 15th October 2014. He was arrested by the Afghan authorities, Afghan intelligence. Jailed. He was recently released as part of one of the swap deals that the Americans forced the Afghan government or the outgoing Afghan government to sign with the Taliban. So he had been released, and since then he's been participating in operations. Then Aziz Haqqani is still there. He's a senior leader and he continues to be there, but he's not seen that much as the others. He's not so active militarily. Omar Haqqani, he was again one of the key military leaders of the Haqqani group. He was killed in 2008 while leading a military operation against the Americans in Khos. In July 2008, he was killed. Then Muhammad Haqqani, he was a military commander, a redoubtable military commander. The Americans were after him. He was killed in North Waziristan in a drone strike by CIA on 18 Feb 2010. And then you see what happened to the rest. There was Nasiruddin Haqqani, another son who was the key financier of the group, also a kind of diplomat and envoy of the group because he was a good Arabic speaker. He was born from the Arabic wife of Jalaluddin Haqqani. He was assassinated in Islamabad on 11 November 2013. Who assassinated him? We don't know. So once again, इसमें कितने राज छुपे हैं पूछे मेरे दिल से तुम, बैठे बैठे महफिल में होता है कोई कैसे गुम। वो इस्लामाबाद में गुम हो गया, एक और पहले मैंने बताया था वो पाकिस्तान की जेल में गुम हो गया। दिस इज द टाइम व्हेन पाकिस्तान वाज प्लेइंग बोथ साइड्स। इट वाज अ स्टॉलवर्ट अलाइव विद द अमेरिकन्स इन द वॉर अगेंस्ट टेरर, बट इट वाज आल्सो द स्टॉलवर्ट पेट्रन ऑफ द तालिबान। दैट इज व्हाई द पाकिस्तानीज आर नाउ सेलिब्रेटिंग द पाकिस्तानी एस्टैब्लिशमेंट, नॉट अ लॉट ऑफ द स्मार्ट पाकिस्तानी पीपल। पाकिस्तानी एस्टैब्लिशमेंट इज नाउ सेलिब्रेटिंग दिस Taliban victory as their own victory because they see Taliban as their own bachas. Then you go further with the sons. Badruddin Haqqani, again a military commander, he was also killed in a drone strike on 24th August 2012. In North Waziristan. He was an operational commander. In fact, he was the head of operations at that time. So he's also gone. Jalaluddin Haqqani himself died in 2013 or thereabouts, apparently of a kidney sickness. We don't know for sure about these people, but that is what is believed. His other surviving son is Sirajuddin Haqqani, who has now risen as the head of the Haqqani network. Now, Haqqani network is not fully in the Taliban discipline. It has autonomy of its own. It has areas which it controls. It also has a mind of its own. So you see, as we go ahead in this story, there might be some twists and turns involving the Haqqani group. So watch that man, Sirajuddin Haqqani, very, very carefully. And remember that his late father, Jalaluddin Haqqani, was such a stalwart ally of the Americans that Americans, who later described him as most dangerous, most sinister, etc., etc., had hailed him in that period as quote-unquote goodness personified, right? He was seen as this great loyalist of the CIA. He was listed as a deep and great and valuable CIA asset. In fact, he had begun operating in Afghanistan from 1975 onwards. That is when Daud Khan was ruling Afghanistan, and there was an Islamist insurgency against him. He was under pressure from Afghan authorities to escape. Where do they escape? He escaped to Pakistan, based himself in Biran Shah in Afghanistan. And from there, he was running his insurgency against Daud Khan and later became a CIA asset and raised this big group for the CIA. In fact, his transformation in the CIA's view was quite dramatic, because as Al-Qaeda grew, he then came to be identified as among the first people to give full protection to Osama bin Laden. And now the CIA started calling him a most dangerous terrorist. That is how these things often go. In fact, you can find details of this in Steve Call's book, The Bin Ladens. I think it was published in 2007 or 2008. I think likely 2008. He was also, Jalaluddin Haqqani also served as Minister of Justice later in the Mujahideen government, and later with the Taliban government, he had another role. With the Taliban government, he became Minister for Border and Tribal Affairs. So once again, CIA asset, Mujahideen leader, Mujahideen minister, Taliban leader, Taliban minister, and then a CIA target. And now his son is in a key position. Now, as Akhundzada became the chief Amir of the Taliban, he appointed two deputies. One of those two deputies, I told you, is Mullah Baradar, who's now become president. The other is Mullah Yaqub, who is a son of Mullah Omar. Mullah Omar was the original founder of the Taliban. Now, Mullah Yaqub did not automatically succeed Mullah Omar, but he is now like the head of the military section of the Taliban. So he's one of the two deputies of Akhundzada. So if Akhundzada becomes a bit of a figurehead, you can imagine that there might be some khijatani, some tension between Baradar and Mullah Yaqub. Now, Mullah Yaqub has been heading the military commission for the Taliban. He also issued an appeal which was noted internationally when the Taliban was making rapid gains to Taliban soldiers or Taliban militants, fighters, whatever you call them. He issued an appeal to them that now is the time for forgiveness, so please stop reprisals. How seriously he meant it, we will see as time passes now.